to invite Shabana ji and Payal onto the stage and we can have a Q&A. And first we would like to invite Shabana ji to please share her thoughts and subsequently after that we can have a discussion.
The film tells it all. I don't think any more words are needed after that. I think what is important is that we should be engaged, each one of us, and make sure that people around us get engaged with one that is such a vital issue when it comes to the safety of women. All of us stand up in horror and say that the incidents of rape and molestation are increasing, and we are horrified by that. But we don't look at different angles from which it makes the situation even worse. And so I really would like to congratulate Payal for the wonderful research that she's done and Sumit for making this film, for opening up our eyes. I have been working in the slums for 30 years now, and many of these issues are issues that we have grappled with. One thing is evident, that a slum is a slum not only because it is made of plastic and bamboo, but because of the slum-like conditions that happen because of the lack of civic amenities and sanitation. We cannot talk about lofty ideas like Swachh Bharat campaign, which is indeed something we need urgently, without looking at the grassroots, checking the reality, and seeing for ourselves. What I like about the film is that it has not just pointed out the problems, but has also given us solutions. And I offer my services to you. If you want me to take you to the Chief Minister with this report, I'll do it very happily. And in whatever way I can join the campaign, I would like to join you.
Slums in Bombay defecate openly, I think
that. And you can do the math, because 70% of Mumbai lives in the slums. And of that 20% is just the official figures. Now, there is a slum in Mumbai, at the Juhu Beach, at the end of Juhu Beach, where even today people are openly defecating. Now, when I was a member of parliament, I said that, you know, that slum has been in existence for 20 years. You keep saying that it is an illegal slum because you can't give it any facilities. But I, as a member of parliament, am willing to build temporary toilets in the slum. I ran from pillar to post right up to the municipal commissioner and the chief minister, and nothing has happened in that yet. Because we keep getting entangled in this whole process of illegal. I question the right of what is illegal. What is illegal? These are people who belong to our country. They have come from the rural areas, they migrate to the city in search of work, not in search of housing. Work they find, but they do not get housing. And within housing, they do not get toilets. Now, unless you have facility for sanitation and civic amenities, how can any human being survive? So is it fair for us to say this is legal and that is illegal? That is something that we need to question. We also need to impress upon the government that unless the government has a bank of land on which the economically legal sections get subsidized rates for housing, nobody who lives in the slums can afford to pay land at market prices that you have in Mumbai. But this is a builder-driven city. What the builder wants is what the politician wants. And that's why public action, civil society action is very important. And like rightly said, to leave it all to the government is not going to be enough. Each one of us have to be responsible, at least for the people who are around us. Each one of us at least have one maid, one boy who looks after a house. Have we ever bothered to find out what are the living conditions of those people? Those people who are serving us. People just look down and say, oh, the slums are dirty, we want the slums to disappear. So when you're talking about beautiful Bombay, are you talking about cosmetic beauty? Are you talking about beautiful life for all the citizens of the city? We must recognize that 70% of the city lives in slums. These are our workforce. The boy who brings in the newspaper, the woman who brings the milk, the lady who cleans your vessels, your driver, all these people who make your life comfortable are people who live in the slums. We cannot have a one-way relationship with them. Say that we will use you for cheap labor and after that you disappear into thin air. I think we can start today by telling ourselves that the people we work for, the people who work for us, who make our lives comfortable, let's ask them, what are your living conditions? Thank you.
Hi, you focused on... Hi, I'm Roshni Shekhar. I'm from the social media team for Kalamunda. I just wanted to know that you have focused on the situations of women. Are there any problems faced by men in the slums?
Of course, there are problems faced both by men and women. In fact, this is a very common question that comes. If you take the report, you'll see on the first page itself, I've tried to explain this. When we talk about sanitation, it affects both men and women. But the way it affects women is way more. You know, it's larger in terms of loss of dignity, in terms of safety, in terms of health problems. That's why I'd like to say here that when we talk about sanitation, women and sanitation is a special focus because of the grave problems that they face. But yeah, of course, men, women, and people from third gender, everyone faces a lot of problems.
Hello, my name is Sirena. My question is to Sabana ji. 30 years you have said you have spent your time in this slum walking. 30 years I have guessed is a very long period. So I would like to know a few of your, you know, challenging tasks you have done for the slum. Just I am interested to know. And for the youth.
What was the question?
Can you repeat the question?
any landmark moments of your 30 years, Nivara Cup?
Oh yes, Nivara Cup is an organization that I've been working with for the last 30 years, since 1986. And our biggest achievement so far is that we have provided 280 square foot tenements for 50,000 people. It is the single largest rehabilitation project in the world. But there also we are facing a problem. These were slum dwellers who had been evicted from the national park. So it starts with struggle. It starts with the Supreme Court recognizing that 30,000 of these people have, according to policy, the right to get alternative accommodation. Then we get into a relationship with a private builder and the Slum Rehabilitation Authority and Nivara to house these people, to build them. But the builder is only interested in making money. With the amount of facility the builder gets under the Slum Rehabilitation Act, for transfer of development rights. If you have a slum like the one that I'm talking about, you made buildings. 80,000 people are settled there, which is a township. Now you cannot have, fortunately, where we've done it, we've given them all individual toilets. But there is no water, there is no market, there is no dispensary, there is nothing. You cannot recreate an entire township and not have what are basic facilities. So these are elements also that you have to look at. But you know, I am happy that this particular film brings about the question of safety for women. Because we are concerned about safety of women, but we don't look at it from different angles. Now, a recent report showed that 70% in rural India, 70% of women suffer from urinary tract infections. And this is because they do not use sanitary napkins. They use cloth, which they wash and recycle. Now that cloth is very identifiable as cloth that you're using during the menstrual cycle. So they don't dry it in the sun. They put it under their cots where they get infections. In actual fact, what we are saying that in 2015, there is not even a spot of sunlight that women can call their own. These are the grassroots realities that lead to so many health problems, and no society can call itself a civilized society unless these basic issues are
tackled. Hi, congratulations. I mean, I think I could relate to this movie a lot because I work with students who come from all over slums. My question for you is that in all the recommendations that you and your team has offered in the movie, how do you plan, if you plan to, engage the audience in sense, like the women who were in the movie and the women that you might have interviewed and worked with?
So, I think that's a question. So, how are
we
trying to
do it? Yeah, in whatever work that will follow from here on, are they going to be part of the work as well?
So, to start with, the first thing that we want to do right now is take the film back to the communities where we shot it so that they know what came out of the interviews. And subsequently take it forward. So we want to use both top-down and bottom-up approaches in making noise about it.
That is a very unfortunate part that institutions
institutions like radio stations, sometimes even shops, sometimes marketplaces, religious places, they don't have. So we have a larger study of sanitation where we covered all these aspects, and we actually found out that, you know, there are a scarcity of clean toilets, but there's even a scarcity of toilets for women. That is because of our attitude, you know, because we think that we don't want to have toilets for women. The number is very skewed. We have to hold institutions accountable for this, and we have to talk about it. As of now, we can only make noise. So while we're talking about toilets, we can't just go to community toilets. We also have to talk about various other institutions. So while women are going from their house to work, where are they going? How are they going while they are at work? For example, hawkers. We don't know where they are going. They are going to public toilets, and it's crazy there. You know, you have to pay 2 rupees every time. So we have to make noise right now. That's all I can say about that. And to answer your question, you said that how can we get people to talk about? So I'd like to share our anecdotes that in the beginning also I said that sometimes we have to go back to the community again and again, to the point that something needed help with employment and getting them in touch with people, opening up our contacts, etc. So these issues are considered taboos, but I think within certain strata of society, when you really go to these people who are facing it on a daily basis, they are ready to talk about it. If you ask them the right questions, they are willing to talk about it. When we were shooting this film, we actually told them that they've used the names of the cooperators. So we asked them, can we take it to the cooperator? They said, yes, of course, take it, because we are willing, you know, we'll go everywhere with you. So yeah, we have taboos, but we have to go to them. We have to be very sensitive in our approach. We have to see what time is it, are they busy, we have to take care of all those issues, but they are ready to talk about it.
I shot the film, and for me it was very difficult to make them talk, because Pai was there and she's a woman and she could relate to it, she could make them talk, and you know, she could
yeah,
make them happy. That's why we could actually come up with these interviews, otherwise it was not possible.
Okay, so thank you.
Yeah, Brockman.